News. I'm Mark Remillard. Facing off at a social distance, President Trump and Democrat Joe Biden meet for the first presidential debate of 2020.
The debate topic list came out days before the New York Times revelations that the president appeared to have paid little in federal income taxes, so that's likely to come up. The other questions? The Supreme Court, the pandemic, the economy, the summer's racial protests, and how the nation can guarantee that this election isn't, as the president repeatedly claims, rigged.
ABC's Andy Field. The Times says Mr. Trump paid little or no federal income taxes over the past decade. North Dakota Republican Senator Kevin Cramer questioning that reporting.
What you're talking about is a very small part of taxes, his personal income taxes. He pays millions and millions of dollars in people's, Social Security, Medicare. Hires a lot of people who pay personal income taxes, pays a lot in property taxes.
2019 returns released by the Biden campaign show the former vice president and his wife paid nearly $300,000 in taxes on almost $1 million in income. The Walt Disney Company says due to reduced capacity at its Florida parks and an inability to reopen its California parks, it'll lay off 28,000 employees. ABC's Alex Stone.
This puts a lot of pressure on Governor Gavin Newsom to let theme parks open here in California. Really, many of these jobs are now up to him to essentially save. And the Disney is saying part of the reason for many of these layoffs is Disneyland and California Adventure not being allowed to open. But for now, 28,000 parks employees are being told they're being laid off.
Disney is the parent company of ABC News. The president of the University of Notre Dame apologizing for not wearing a mask at Saturday's Rose Garden ceremony for Supreme Court nominee Amy Coney Barrett. The Reverend John Jenkins can be seen in photos shaking hands. Researchers at the University of Missouri are collecting survey data and voluntary blood samples to study the prevalence of COVID-19 antibodies in the campus community. This is ABC News.
Morning.
How'd you get in my house, B?
Through the air conditioning vent. It's dark in there.
Go away.
How about some Honey Nut Cheerios?
Cheerios. Do I look like a child to you?
Honey Nut Cheerios are tasty and can help lower cholesterol as part of a heart-healthy diet. Did you just
No.
I'm pretty sure I heard a
It was my dryer.
You might want to get that thing checked out.
Have a change of heart. Honey Nut Cheerios. Learn more about Honey Nut Cheerios by picking up a box at your local store.
Third floor study hall.
My dining room table.
Homeroom Monday and Tuesday. My living room Wednesday to Friday.
Wherever school happens for you this year, Staples has amazing prices on everything your student needs. This week, get 20% off copies and prints for school. That's 20% off posters, worksheets, schedules, and reports. Shop in-store or pick up curbside. School on, save on. Staples. Visit staples.com/schoolprinting for coupon. In-store only. Exclusions apply. Ends 10/31. Curbside available in most stores.
Illinois Governor J.B. Pritzker says he'll quarantine for 2 weeks after a member of his administration tested positive for coronavirus. The staff member attended events all last week with the governor. Congress hasn't given up on another COVID economic stimulus package.
Stalled negotiations on a COVID-19 relief bill appear to have gotten new steam. Since unveiling the $2.2 trillion relief bill on Monday, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi going over provisions of the updated HEROES Act with the Treasury Secretary multiple times. The slimmed-down COVID relief measure includes a new round of $600 a week added jobless benefit and $1,200 in direct payments to most Americans. Though the bill is $1.2 trillion less than a previously proposed measure, it's still well above what Senate Republicans have indicated they'll accept. Faith Abube, ABC News, Washington.
Tampa International Airport says it's launching the country's first airport COVID-19 testing program for all passengers. They'll have both the nasal swab and rapid test, which will be optional. Mark Remillard, ABC News.
It's 7:04, 4 past 7. I'm Donnelly at the KOFO Newsroom with this hour's top stories. Ottawa city officials have been handling quite a few questions lately concerning tiny homes. The question is, how small of a home can someone live in, and does the city have any type of regulations on where a tiny home can be placed? Sarah Anzacek with the Ottawa Community Development Department says she's heard of some extremely tiny houses.
I don't know, building code-wise, how small you could go, but I know when we went to that tiny home symposium, there was a lady who lived in like 80 square feet or something like that. That's how she preferred to live. This Lake Dallas tiny home village in Dallas is a tiny home village, 13 tiny homes on 1 acre of land that range in size from 200 to 400 square feet in size.
Anzacek is drawing up some proposed tiny home regulations for review by the Ottawa Planning Commission. President Trump and USDA Secretary Perdue announced the second round of aid through the coronavirus food assistance program. up to $14 billion will be used to help farmers devastated by the economic disaster caused by the COVID-19 pandemic. The first round provided support to livestock, dairy, non-specialty, and specialty crop producers throughout the country. Many farmers were initially left out, and although the program was expanded to include more commodities, American Farm Bureau Federation President Zippy Duval says farmers and ranchers saw demand for their markets disappear during the initial shockwave of the pandemic. Even though concerns over food supplies have now lessened, the economic hardships are still taking their toll on farm families across the country. Sign up for the assistance program started Monday and will run through December 11th. The exclusive KOFO Weather Center forecast will have a clear night tonight, the low down to 49. It'll be a sunny day tomorrow, near perfect 80 for a high. Tomorrow night, clear skies, a low down to 43. It'll be a sunny Thursday, cooler, 64 the expected high. Thursday night, there is that chance of patchy frost developing after 5 a.m. Otherwise, clear skies, 36 for a low. Friday, some patchy frost possible before 8 a.m. Otherwise, sunshine throughout the day with a high of 63. And for Friday night, it'll be partly cloudy, the low bottoming out at 43. And that brings you up to date. I'm Don Elliott, KOFO News. Get ready for the Ken Kessinger Show, live from the Primetime Grill at Fusion Alley, just moments away on KOFO.
Stay tuned for the following special presentation from 1220 and 103.7 FM KOFO.
KOFO, your sports source for East Central Kansas and home of Ottawa University Athletics, welcomes you to the Ken Kessinger Show, live from our new location, Primetime Grill at Fusion Alley. You can join us live at Primetime Grill during the show and enjoy a special discount on the Tasty Braves Burger while you're there. While we talk with OU Braves head football coach, Ken Kessinger. Tonight's show is brought to you by Primetime Grill at 2204 South Princeton Circle Drive in South Ottawa, and by State Farm Insurance agent Keith King, Dingle and Son Mortuary, and Ottawa University. Now let's go live to Primetime Grill and join the host of the Ken Kessinger Show on KOFO, Bob Johnson.
And welcome in to the Ken Kessinger Show live from Primetime Grill at Fusion Alley. It's our new location at 2204 South Princeton Circle Drive here in South Ottawa. Good evening, everybody. I am Bob Johnson as we get ready to take you to the top of the hour as we talk about Ottawa University Braves football with the man, the myth, the legend himself sitting to my right, head coach Ken Kessinger. Coach, welcome.
Oh, thanks. It's good to be here.
It is nice
out,
to have
out
you
in
here.
Public, even.
Well, first of all, a good thing is you're healthy. That's that.
Oh, yeah.
That everyone,
yeah.
That's good. You're doing well. Everyone seems to be doing well. As far as the update on your team members, how are they doing?
They're doing pretty good. A little bit stir crazy right now after spending the last couple weeks in a quarantine where they really can't get out and do much. We've extended that a little bit to where we're in kind of a self-imposed quarantine, you know, within the university, within our sport. So they are able to get out a little bit, but we're still not practicing right now. And looks like hopefully we can get back to that next week.
And looking early next week, roughly?
Right. I think at the beginning of next week, it sounds like through Sunday to be able to start up and, you know, doing most things on Monday. But this is a very fluid type of environment right now. And obviously, just with the whole pandemic as it started way back in January and everything like that, things change, you know, on a moment's notice. And that's one of the things that I talked to our players about when they first came in the fall, is that we were going to have to be flexible, that there was going to be things that came up. We did everything, you know, we were going to do everything that we could to mitigate circumstances, but you really don't know how to prepare for the unknown. You're just going to have to roll with it when it comes. And that's what we're trying to do right now.
So as everything continues to hold steady, you begin to get yourself ready by practicing. So the game on the 10th of October against Avila would then be a go unless something else came up.
Yeah, it will be. It's you know, as a coach, we want to play, but as a coach, I'm looking at the fact that, you know, we won't have practiced football for 3 weeks, and it's not. not like some other sports where you can just go out there and just play it. I mean, there's a lot more that's involved with it. And so I've got, you know, it's one of those situations as we get into that week that I think that I'm going to have conversations, obviously, with our staff and our players and then with our administrators to see, you know, how that game goes on the 10th. I mean, everybody wants to play. I mean, our players want to get out and practice. They want to get out and play the game. And we as coaches want to do the same thing. But we need to make sure that, you know, just as we're doing with the quarantining, that we're putting the student athlete and them personally and their safety as the number one issue. And you got to be able to do that with playing the game too.
Exactly. And that's, we talked about that during the summer with podcasts, that first of all, you've got to convince parents at this stage right now that to send their kids, but then you've got to not only convince them that, but convince them that they're going to be safe.
Oh, yeah. And from the standpoint, I think of the type of sport that football is, I mean, being a contact sport, being a very physical contact sport, is you got to look at, you got to look at the whole getting yourself back into a game, not shape, but in a game, I guess ability to be able to play the way that it's supposed to be able to be played from the point that you take 3 weeks off, and there's going to be rust, but what is the other parts that are, what's the other tangential things that are going to occur because of taking that time off? Because initially at the beginning of the year, the reason that football started a week after everybody else playing competition is that Athletic Trainers Association and the Strength and Conditioning Association and those people came together and said that you had to have minimum 4 weeks of practices before you play, that acclimatization period. How does that factor in, you know, after a layoff, what we've had or what we will have with 3 weeks?
Well, and that is a scary point that you bring up, because you take a look at the first few weeks of the NFL season, you didn't have a whole lot going on during preseason. You didn't have any preseason games, and there is a who's. It's an all-pro team that's out for the rest of the year because of injuries. And that begs the question to me, did the conference ever put a thought process into how much is too much time and how to get teams back? Because you have to be in the right shape to play this game.
Yeah.
You just can't run out there and throw on the gear and expect everything to go well.
And we do have a little bit of that in place. You know, particularly like for the student athletes that, you know, at some point or another they test positive for COVID and they come back. There is a return to play protocol, which is, you know, it's quite extensive. It's actually, I think, a really good thing. They have to meet with the doctor. They get some of the similar testing that you've heard the Big 12 is going to do with the heart and the blood testing and that sort of thing. Then they go through a series of 7 days progression to where it builds them up to full activity. So even if they get done, let's say on a Monday, if they get released with the doctor's visit, then they have 7 days after that. So they're not going to play till the following week, which is, I think, a very good deal. I don't know if, you know, how does that affect those people that are healthy, though, that sat out for an extended period of time, you know, 1 week or 2 weeks, you can kind of say, all right, I guess that's going to be something that we're going to find out. And that's going to be something as a coach that I'm going to really try to gauge as we get back into practices and be able to say, I think that, you know, that we're okay, we're good to go from a standpoint of the sport itself and what it's going to be involved with, or I'm going to have to make a hard decision and say, no, I think that it's best that we don't. And, you know, where the chips fall where they may, right now we still have 3 games that we can schedule yet in the spring. So there's 6 total weeks of the spring that you can be playing games. Right now we have 3 of them filled because of bumping the 3 games. So we got space, we got time. And, you know, I'd rather be in a situation where our team, you know, has an opportunity to be successful, but also be, you know, be safe and stuff. So,
yeah, I mean, that's a huge key in itself. You want to be successful, but safety is just paramount. And especially with an injury, you know, you blow out an ACL, you tear an Achilles, things like that, that effectively could take care of someone's playing days on the team, period. So you want to make sure that you're careful.
And we've been trying to do things so for the last about, well, it'll be a week and a half total, as we get to the end of this week, that we've been doing things outside with some of, you know, in small groups. So we're anywhere between 15 to 20 people. Our strength and performance staff is running them through about a 25 to 30 minute conditioning type of workout every other day, and then the alternate days they're doing, you know, I guess for older people they would call them calisthenics, but it's more body weight strength things that you can do outside, you know, like you would see maybe in the military or something like that, where they have them in a field in an area. So like today they did that. It was a lot of, you know, body squats, bridges, push-ups, different types of muscle activity type things, because what we're trying to also eliminate is those soft tissue injuries that you can get, the pulls, the hamstrings, and that sort of thing, and hope that the little bit of the conditioning that we're going to get is going to be able to build upon that, because it's one of those things. You get to 2 weeks, you should be okay with conditioning. You get to three, it's going to be a little bit less, so that's why we're doing that right now.
Sounds like you wrote a paper about this or something.
I didn't write a paper, but I've studied enough. I think that maybe that doctoral stuff is coming in handy right now.
Hey, who knew that would happen? But, well, you probably did, because you're a smart man.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Yeah, exactly. Let's take our first break of the evening right here. When we come back, we're going to bring on my tag team partner for the broadcast, Casey Weider. We're going to talk a little bit about the all-time team between 2007 and 2019 that we put together this last summer and posted it on the web. We're going to discuss a little bit about that when we come back. But don't forget, we're here at Primetime Grill until the top of the hour. Enjoy delicious Kansas cuisine, appetizers, salads, burgers, and sandwiches, prime courses, fresh sides, kids' menus, sweets for dessert, and all beverages can be found here at Primetime Grill. You're listening to The Kit Kessinger Show on 1220 and 103.7 FM KOFO and KOFO.com.
Hey, next time you're at the store, don't forget the ingredients to make your own sunflower salad with mixed greens, olives, cheddar cheese, sunflower seeds, and dressing. Oh, and the 14-ounce ribeye with mashed potatoes and seasoned vegetables. And I'm sure you won't have trouble finding everything for the homemade peach and blackberry cobbler topped with oatmeal cookie crust and vanilla ice cream. What? You don't cook for your family like this every night? Oh, well, that's how the folks at Primetime Grill do it, for you and your family. Dine in or order online at primetimegrill.com and get contactless curbside pickup. Primetime Grill at Fusion Alley in South Ottawa.
This is Craig Dingle of Dingle & Son Mortuary. When you buy a monument from us, you can count on us to set your stone so that it will remain stable through the years. We pour a substantial amount of fresh concrete with stabilizing piers for the base. A monument is a permanent recording of your family history, and you have every right to expect it to be standing straight and tall for future generations to see. We have been here for generations, and we'll be here to back our guarantee.
Dingle & Son Mortuary, 785-242-2323.
It's never too late to become who you're supposed to be. However, sometimes you may need a little help. Ottawa University can get you there. Their faculty and staff are dedicated to preparing graduates for a lifetime of significance. With dozens of degree programs, including accounting, engineering, human services, and marketing, as well as graduate degrees in business administration and education, Ottawa University will prepare you for whatever or whoever you want to be. Don't wait. Get started today. Find out more by visiting online at ottawa.edu.
Let's face it, auto insurance can be confusing. Do you know your comprehensive from your collision, your no fault from liability, your premium from your deductible? After an accident is no time to find out that your definition of full coverage is actually different from what your policy says. Let local State Farm insurance agent Keith King explain auto insurance in terms you can understand.
I'm State Farm insurance agent Keith King. Let's work together to be sure your vehicle has the coverage you need. Call and schedule an appointment today at 242-9435. Stop by my office at 111 South Main in Ottawa or visit online at keithking.com.
Liberty. Liberty Mutual Insurance Company customizes your home insurance so you only pay for what you need.
As a minimalist, paying less for insurance is more.
Nice place.
Is your house a bubble?
It's a dome. I find corners unnecessary.
At Liberty Mutual, that's how we feel about overpaying for insurance.
But I do miss having shelves.
What would you put on them?
Nothing, obviously.
Only pay for what you need at libertymutual.com.
Liberty, 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 liberty.
You hear that? That's my kids destroying my house. Normally that would stress me out, but I'm taking a Vicks Vapo bath. So now I'm floating.
Plus the husband's watching them.
Vicks Vapo bath crystals are for any time you need to de-stress. Let the soothing scent of Vicks Vapors create a little escape whenever you need it. Which, in this household, is a lot. So transform your bath time with new Vicks Vapo bath crystals. Find them in a store near you.
Sometimes I wish the talk during the break could make it on the air. Because the barbs were flying. And that's because, as I mentioned, my tag team partner, he's the voice of a generation, let's face it. He is the best broadcaster in the KCAC. He is Casey Weider. Casey, welcome, and thank you for joining us.
Thanks, Bob. I appreciate that. I would probably put you and Pat Strothman up there, maybe one and two. And then Nick Gosnell pretty close to number three, and then I would be a number four.
Well, that's I would definitely not put myself in that two spot. So I would say maybe just outside the top ten. But we brought you on here because we put together a much maligned.
Maligned is the word you're going for.
All OU team over the 13 years. That I've done the games, and then of course you were around for most of those 13 years, all of those. So, of course, as it said in the disclaimer on this, that this is meant for fun. It's the opinions of two broadcasters who have watched Braves football over the past 13 years. Plus, since I don't get to hang out in the locker room, watch film, or do anything like that, I'm doing just off of what I've been able to do. So anyway, let the barbs begin. So Casey, we put together these teams. You have yours. Obviously, we chose to go with Ethan Haller as our quarterback. When you think about quarterbacks under Coach Kessinger, either it's Ethan, and then I would say Bobby Adamson, in that second spot, but Ethan Haller's number one all the way.
I would agree with you guys both. You chose wisely with Ethan. He might, if he's not, I would be surprised. I would have to go back in history of Ottawa University, but I don't think you'd find a better quarterback in the history of Ottawa University.
I agree. That's an easy number one for me, and he might have said 15 words his entire time in Ottawa, but I can probably remember all 15. He didn't say a whole lot, in the locker room but when he did say stuff, everyone listened and was someone that led by example. And, sometimes I'll go back and watch that 09 highlight film, and a lot of times the throws that he made were under immense pressure, took a lot of shots, but a lot of times ended up in touchdowns. So a guy that the general was going to stand back there and make that throw.
Yeah, it's a good choice, you guys. That's a good choice on that one.
I would say for record wise, I think Ethan is the top quarterback.
He's got to have all the records. There's a quarterback that was here, I think, during Coach Creighton's time that was pretty good. The name is just leaving me now, but. He's pretty solid, but Ethan, I don't think many of his passing records will ever be broken.
Absolutely not. Now, Casey, for running back, you took Luke Lundy. I did the same thing. For me, you've got all KCAC first team, 13 and 14 and 15. He was 2014 and 2015 KCAC Player of the Year. An AFCA All-American second teamer. And to me, I think he had an opportunity to maybe catch on with the pro side if it wasn't for an injury.
But you're exactly right. I mean, he was the final cut for the Browns in that training camp, and all of that due to three concussions he had as part of that training camp. So a guy that could be in the league, and I mean, from the moment he stepped on campus, actually when my senior year, he was on the sidelines during one of the games. He came on his visit from Fort Scott, and from the get-go, you kind of knew he was going to be something special. And then once you handed him the football, it was game over most of the time. It took six, seven, eight guys to bring him down, and had a little bit of shiftiness to him too.
Yeah, he is one of the best backs that I've had a chance to coach in my career. And just physical runner, had good hands out of the backfield as well, and had tremendous speed, and one of the most violent stiff arms that I think I'd ever seen. As a matter of fact, there was officials that we'd played in a game, and I think it was either Southwestern or KDEV because they were purple. That's the only thing I remember about it. But he just pretty much pummeled this kid into the turf, and a couple weeks later we had the same officials, and they came over and they were remarking about how, you know, physical he was, and one of the officials said to the other one, he says, well, why didn't you call a flag on the stiff arm, and you know, to not use the French that he used, but he said it was the best blank stiff arm he's ever seen in his life. He couldn't throw a flag on it.
Well, and he also had some glorious hair. So
he did. When I first saw him, and they said that we had a, you know, a defensive end and a linebacker from Fort Scott up, and then a running back, I looked over there and I go, that's a pretty good sized, you know, defensive end. And sure enough, he was the running back. So that was pretty positive.
Not a lot in the KCAC to bring him down.
No, for sure.
Of course, for fullback, I chose Michael Wickley, and Casey, you went, you didn't really pick a fullback.
No, I did. I did my second. You didn't really give us parameters on that one, so yeah, that's on you, Buck. No, on my second one, you know, of course, I had Wickley. Kyle Hopps could be another one that you could mention, another physical fullback back there. You know, it's, you know, Wickley, I think, was just someone that, from the time, you know, I met him, you know, he was a sophomore and I was a freshman, but someone that worked hard in the weight room, you know, changed really his whole physique and changed the type of player he was as an offensive lineman in high school. And then he was someone that I think the whole team rallied around, you know, that you saw that he put in a lot of work and got to a point where he was someone we'd give the ball to on the goal line in 2010. And just one of those guys, you know, stuck with the program for 4 or 5 years and got some substantial reps towards the final year. And it's funny, you know, you would watch him on film and like the linebacker would never see him. He put his helmet right in their gut by the time they figured it out where he was, and was going to clear path for the tailbacks for sure.
Yeah, he was good, you know, for a very seldom used position in the Coach K offensive schematology. He was fantastic, and I agree with you too. Kyle Hopp is also a good one. They're kind of like a 1A and 1B, but he definitely, Wickley brought more personality. I mean, Kyle had good personality, but Wickley had an abundance of it for a little guy. So we'll just stick with that.
The human bowling ball, as I would refer to him as during those broadcasts, and full of life. That's probably the best way to put it. Wide receiver, this was a spot where you could take you could pick a few different ones, but for myself, you could not take Clarence Anderson. He had to be in that list. Darian Dillard and Josh Stangby, to me, would be those three that I would choose. And of course, Casey, with your list, who did you have?
I had that same three on my second team. You know, I had Corey Schultz, John Hilliger, and Matt Middleton. And, you know, Cheese and Matt Middleton kind of laid the foundation, I think, for Clarence, someone that made the transition over to wide receiver. But with Clarence, you know, his biggest thing is first time he touched the ball went for a touchdown, that kick return against Bethel. Only other player I can remember doing that was Shane Gimzo, and another player, he had basically a QB sneak against Tabor in 09 that went for 6. So a pretty special. Clarence ran into just a pile of defenders on that kick return in 08 and popped out, and that basically sealed the win for us then. And from then on out, you know, once he had a feel for the offense and knew, you know, what was coming, he was pretty unstoppable.
See, yeah, now here's where, I mean, I agree with all three of these, but here's where you got to take into account the style of offense that we have, too. I mean, the fact that you only listed three receivers is, I mean, you might almost have had to make this like a, you know, the Dirty Dozen or a Baker's Dozen for the actual people that we'd use in a game, because I think that without Corey Schultz, you don't have Clarence Anderson being as good as he was in 09. I mean, he would have been good as an athlete, but Corey Schultz pretty much ran that thing, and plus Corey Schultz and him would go back and forth leading the nation in receiving that year. You can't, you know, Darian Dillard, you know, if I had to pick a jet personnel, four wides or something like that, I definitely put Darian at one of my receivers, probably Corey out there to direct traffic, Clarence Anderson at the slot. I put him in the slot. Could you imagine him on all the fly sweeps and stuff that people do nowadays with that? And then if I, you know, you were going to talk about tight ends, if I needed to substitute a tight end, that sort of thing, I'd probably put in Josh, you know, because now, I mean, the speed that you would have on the field would just be unbelievable within the height that you have with Darian and Corey Schultz. That would be a pretty scary set of receivers to come at you, for sure.
And Bob, I really think, you know, with Corey Schultz, he also helped with that maturation process with Clarence. He kind of brought Clarence out of a shell, I think. Corey's someone that's going to, you know, kind of get after you a little bit. He's going to joke around. But I think, you know, when Clarence came in, pretty reserved person, I think Corey kind of brought him out of that shell, in my mind. And kind of, you know, he was a leader for us in 08. And as we were learning to win, you know, he came from K-State, which was always, had always been a winner. And, you know, just someone that kind of brought the level of, you know, of talent, you know, up to a new standard, and someone that kind of brought everyone with him, whether it was in special teams, returning punts, you know, or you know, I could definitely see how he could be in that one. But I, you know, this was one of the toughest position groups to pick out, because there's just so many playmakers that we've had from 2007 until now that can go up and get the football, and then not only that, but yards after catch too.
Yeah, and I think that's where you guys, you know, one thing we could put also in here was a utility player, and that's where you throw Shane Gimso in. I mean, one of the toughest kids to ever play that, you know, in our program since I've been here. I mean, really, one of the toughest dudes out there, offensively, defensively, whatever. Could be quarterback, could be receiver. The toughest move for him was his, I think it was his senior year when we moved him to full-time quarterback, because then he didn't have himself to throw to. And that's where John Hilliger, you know, started branching out. So you move your best receiver to quarterback, and then he doesn't have the best receiver to throw to anymore because he's the one playing quarterback. But that's a loaded position that we've had. And, you know, your second team, you know, if you had a second team, they'd still be pretty good consulted players.
Probably be a first team on a lot of other teams.
Yeah, definitely.
We're going to take our break right here. When we come back, we'll continue this discussion with Casey Weiner and head coach Kent Kessinger. You're listening to the Kent Kessinger Show live from Primetime Grill at Fusion Alley. Hey, come on out and eat with us during the live show. I mean, you know, we're nice people, and the staff here is fantastic. The food is great. The staff is all masked up. There's extra cleaning and sanitizing for your health, and the distancing of tables. So come on out, join us here for some dining and some Braves football talk. We'll take a break. You're listening to the Kent Kessinger Show on 1220 and 103.7 FM KOFO and KOFO.com.
Let's face it, auto insurance can be confusing. Do you know your comprehensive from your collision, your no fault from liability, your premium from your deductible? After an accident is no time to find out that your definition of full coverage is actually different from what your policy says. Let local State Farm insurance agent Keith King explain auto insurance in terms you can understand.
I'm State Farm insurance agent Keith King. Let's work together to be sure your vehicle has the coverage you need. Call and schedule an appointment today at 242-9435. Stop by my office at 111 South Main in Ottawa, or visit online at keithking.com.
It's never too late to become who you're supposed to be. However, sometimes you may need a little help. Ottawa University. University can get you there. Their faculty and staff are dedicated to preparing graduates for a lifetime of significance. With dozens of degree programs, including accounting, engineering, human services, and marketing, as well as graduate degrees in business administration and education, Ottawa University will prepare you for whatever or whoever you want to be. Don't wait. Get started today. Find out more by visiting online at ottawa.edu.
Have you ever seen a menu that actually made your mouth water? Well, wait till you taste it. The food, not the menu. Lunch at Primetime Grill at Fusion Alley just got better with their new lunch menu, including tasty salads, half sandwiches with a fresh side, a full sandwich and more with fries, all your favorite beverages, and service that gets you back to work in time. You got to do lunch, so why not do it in Primetime? The new lunch menu at Primetime Grill, available Monday through Friday from 11 to 2. See it online at primetimegrill.com. Primetime Grill at Fusion Alley in South Ottawa.
This is Craig Dengel of Dengel and Son Mortuary. We love all of our kids and do stuff for them all the time, even the grown-up kids. I have a suggestion of something you can do that you may not have thought of. Make your funeral arrangements. You can't imagine how stressful it is for families who have no clue as to what their folks wanted or where to find all the information needed for the death certificate. We can help you make formal arrangements, or we can give you forms to fill out at home. Give us a call at any one of our funeral homes. We're glad to help.
Dengel and Son Mortuary, 785-242-2323.
Hiring can be challenging, but ZipRecruiter makes it fast and easy. We talked to Monica Starks, who needed to hire for a pivotal role at her company, GS Group.
As the owner of a construction company, finding the right people is a very difficult task. So I use ZipRecruiter.
ZipRecruiter's powerful matching technology identifies the right people for your job and actively invites them to apply, which is why you should try ZipRecruiter for free at ZipRecruiter.com/free. Monica did, and that's how she found Lamont, her new project superintendent.
The job is so perfect for me. I had a career breakthrough. I would have never found this job if it wasn't for ZipRecruiter.
With ZipRecruiter, we've hired everyone from accountants to project managers to field scientists. With ZipRecruiter, we get hiring results.
See why 4 out of 5 employers who post on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate within the first day. ZipRecruiter, the smartest way to hire. And now you can try ZipRecruiter for free. That's right, free at ZipRecruiter.com/free. That's ZipRecruiter.com/free. ZipRecruiter.com/free.
Have you ever touched a nerve? Well, tonight we're doing so right now with head coach Kent Kessinger as we're discussing our Braves all-time team between 2007 and 2019. Myself, Bob Johnson, Casey Weider, who is my broadcast partner, and of course head coach Kent Kessinger, all here on the show. And I think Coach K's blood pressure may have jumped a few points during the break talking about some of that stuff. But, well, you know, let's move into some of that. Yeah.
We got an easy one, though. This is a softball you're lobbing up here for tight end position.
Well, I mean, yeah. You know, come on, dude.
I mean, that's a no-brainer.
Yeah.
Taylor Burnett, TV, definitely the best tight end we've had. Now, if you go before 2007, you could probably throw Justin Smale into, you know, in my tenure here, he's probably up there. But TB can run, and he can catch. He used to be able to block, but that decreased in each year that he played for us because we did very little blocking with the tight end. Toward the end of things, we just sent him out on pass.
I was going to say most of his blocking wasn't him just pretty much looking back and saying look out.
And no, he didn't do lookouts. He was just more just getting it. I told him finally, I said, just get in the way.
So that's all that matters.
Just get in the way.
You at least wanted him to do something.
Right. Just get in the way. Just shield him off. We're only doing this to rest Ethan's arm anyways. So.
Well, I will throw in, you know, a second one in there on my second team, which was Cody White, a 4-year starter. He was kind of someone that you could put as a hybrid fullback and then played some tight end as well, but racked up over 40 catches in his career. You know, played for 4 years, won 2 or 3 conference championships, just a winner, and someone that could kind of do the hybrid. But I mean, you know, you're not too many 6'5" tight ends, you know, that can get down the field and go up and get the ball the way Taylor Burnett did. So, but I think Cody was a different type of player overall, but he was someone that you could kind of plug in wherever on that offense.
Yeah, he was more of a like the hybrid H-back type thing. So, yeah.
Now the hot button topic number one coming up here, and I am
the trenches. It's in the trenches where you're gonna find most of my arguments.
Well, we got to keep in mind here, there, especially on the defensive line, there has been a lot of talents that has gone through, and it is hard to narrow it down to a starting four.
Right.
Now, offensive line, I admittedly for me, because one, I don't have access to the video,
right.
So I'm not grading people. Number two, I didn't get to hang out with y'all to discuss these, so I'm looking at just players who were rewarded for their play.
Right.
And so
you're just going off of stats.
That's all I have to go off.
Yeah.
Now, admittedly.
No.
Okay, so, you know, Quentin Fleming, Matt Pennington, Julian Mendez, Tyler Riebel, and Trey Bayes were my picks. Casey?
Yeah, I think mine were very similar outside of I put Tyler Gadwood in at center because if I don't think my deep snapper, you know, I'm not gonna hear from him for a long time. So and there wasn't a deep snapper on the list for me to choose from, so I went with Gads on that one. I had some other guys in there, but you know, I plugged in, you know, based off the position. If you do the five best, you know, I would say Trey Bayes and Julian Mendez would be in place of a couple guys I had in there originally. You could throw in Daniel Caldera there at center as well. That 2008-09 offensive line was just so dominant up front, and was so much fun to watch, and you know, have them blocking for me was real nice too.
Yeah, we got if you go back into 2007, you carry on a guy, Dehatra Cervetti, who was a tackle for us. But you know, if you go five offensive line, because really 2009, and we mentioned this in the break, 2009 we played the five guard offensive line because every single one of them was a guard for us that we just moved around. So you know, Julian Mendez moving out to tackle, he was originally a guard. Daniel Caldera moving into center, he was originally a guard. Matt Pennington might have been the only tackle, but he was about the size of a guard. And I would tell you that of all the guys, probably Matt Pennington is the best offensive line because he, you know, played with not only, he played well, but he was fierce in there. So he played with a little chip on his shoulder. He had the great lineman mentality. So you got Pennington for sure, Mendez, Caldera, Dehatra Cervetti. That's four right there out of that. Drew Hunter was a pretty good one. I'd probably, you know, he put him in at maybe a 1A, 1B type thing. You've got, Quinn Flamey was pretty good, and he kind of grew into it. He would probably be a second guy on that. Trey Bayes grew into it as well, and he was pretty solid for us. As well. So, I mean, there are some guys to choose from. They're just not all going to fit into a nice, pretty little tackle guard center stuff type deal like that. So the guys that we had that I had issues with, I'll just keep that after the break and that sort of thing. But
I will say this little thing
about finishing stuff. So,
I will say someone that, you know, is on the team currently that I really enjoyed watching, you know, from his freshman year to now, which I know he's battled through injuries, but I think Arnaldo Mendoza is definitely someone I feel like has good feet, has good size at that tackle spot. Just, you know, trying to stay out of, you know, the injury bug for him. But I think he's someone that, you know, was preseason all conference, continuing to get better as we go on. But I've enjoyed watching him play over the last two or three years.
He definitely has the offensive line look, you know, the nice, sleek, tall, thick look, definitely. So, and I think we got some young guys right now that, you know, we look pretty good coming out there right now, and they got some growth to do, but they would have to do some work to reach some of the levels of some of these guys that we have in here.
I would agree with that. Let's see here. Now, defensive line, this again is a spot. There's just so many people that you could choose from that could fit in there for a first team. For me, I had Deron Bruce, Seth Molka, Jacob Garcia, and Vinny Wurst.
Go ahead, Casey.
Yeah, and I will add in there, I had Zach Van Dusen, very dominant at that D-tackle position. And then on the defensive end in 2007, Brandon Smith, almost unblockable at times for that defense. But I think you kind of covered, you know, basically everyone I had. I had Pierce Hutchins on there, a four-year starter for us. I mean, the D-line and the linebacker spot was probably the hardest choices for me outside of wide receiver, just because you can pick five or six, seven guys, you know, at that front four that you want to go with.
Yeah, I would agree with, you know, some of those. Riverside, definitely Zach Van Dusen was probably one of the premier dominant guys that you could play inside. He could move outside if you needed to. He's definitely on that list. I would say, I would agree with you, as Jacob Garcia is, I think, a little better than Vinny, but Vinny is, it was really strong. You got Brandon Smith, who, you know, on the edge was really good. Seth Homolka on the edge was really good for us. Dron had, I think, his senior year was a good year. Brandon was good for the 2 years he was here. Zach was good for the 2 years. Benny was good for the 4 years. Jacob Garcia is going to hopefully be good for the 4 years that they're here with us. And then Seth Homolka was good for the 2 years. So I think of the ones with Dron is probably the one that had just one shining year out of the bunch, and I'd probably lean myself to some of the other guys that had multiple years of success within our program.
Yeah, I'd say overall, I think Dron was probably the best pure pass rusher. You know, a guy,
yes,
that you could move all over the, you know, all over the defensive line, and you felt like he was going to put pressure on the quarterback. Maybe a little sleeker, a little thinner than some of these other guys, but yeah, I would agree with you on that kick.
Let's take our final break right here. We're going to come back. We'll talk about linebackers and secondary as we wind down here for this edition of the Kent Kessinger Show. If you don't want to come here and eat in person, you can always order online. You can pick up curbside out front. You can order at primetimegrill.com. You can call 785-242-PTG1. And we'll take our final break of the evening. Hey, don't forget, Braves Burger, you get $1 off until close. You're listening to us live on 1220 and 103.7 FM, KOFO, and KOFO.com.
It's never too late to become who you're supposed to be. However, sometimes you may need a little help. Ottawa University can get you there. Their faculty and staff are dedicated to preparing graduates for a lifetime of significance. With dozens of degree programs, including accounting, engineering, human services, and marketing, as well as graduate degrees in business administration and education, Ottawa University will prepare you for whatever or whoever you want to be. Don't wait. Get started today. Find out more by visiting online at ottawa.edu.
This is Walt Dengle of Dengle & Son Mortuary. In 1961, I joined my father, Lewis, in the business to become the second generation. In 82, my son, Craig, joined me and became the third generation at Dengle & Son. I am so pleased the son in our name will still be appropriate for years to come because Chase, Craig's son, has just joined the firm to become the fourth generation. I'm sure my father, Louis, would be proud that the business he started is still in the family and still going strong.
Dengle & Son Mortuary, 785-242-2323.
Let's face it, auto insurance can be confusing. Do you know your comprehensive from your collision, your no-fault from liability, your premium from your deductible? After an accident is no time to find out that your definition of full coverage is actually different from what your policy says. Let local State Farm Insurance Agent Keith King explain auto insurance in terms you can understand.
I'm State Farm Insurance Agent Keith King. Let's work together to be sure your vehicle has the coverage you need. Call and schedule an appointment today at 242-9435. Or stop by my office at 111 South Main in Ottawa or visit online at Keith.
Hey, next time you're at the store, don't forget the ingredients to make your own sunflower salad with mixed greens, olives, cheddar cheese, sunflower seeds, and dressing. Oh, and the 14-ounce ribeye with mashed potatoes and seasoned vegetables. And I'm sure you won't have trouble finding everything for the homemade peach and blackberry cobbler topped with oatmeal cookie crust and vanilla ice cream. What? You don't cook for your family like this every night? Oh, well, that's how the folks at Primetime Grill do it, for you and your family. Dine in or order online at primetimegrill.com and get contactless curbside pickup. Primetime Grill at Fusion Alley in South Ottawa.
Did you know a fire department responds to a fire every 24 seconds? First Alert is reminding you to be ready for the unexpected by installing smoke and carbon monoxide alarms on every level and in every bedroom of your home. Don't forget to add First Alert fire extinguishers on every level and in common spaces like the kitchen, especially if you're cooking more and know how to use them. Protect your whole home with reliable protection you can trust by visiting firstalert.com and Lowe's stores today.
Join Macy's in support of Girls Inc. throughout the month of September. Here's how you can help. Make a donation today at Macy's.com and also give back when you shop at any Macy's store. Round up your purchase amount and donate your extra change, up to 99 cents, to Girls Inc. Your donation will help fund life-changing mentoring experiences to inspire girls across the country to be strong, smart, and bold. Make your donation to Girls Inc. today at Macy's stores and Macy's.com/Macy's Gives.
Stretch here on the Ken Kessinger Show, live from Primetime Grill, and also the home of Fusion Alley, where you'll find good, clean fun. Also home of the Ottawa University Braves bowling teams. And, we've just been running along here. It's just gone so smoothly. We forgot to say hello to people.
Yeah, definitely. You got to say hello to my mother-in-law listening in, and you know, my folks probably listening in. You know, the people in the Borg, because they don't, you know, have anything to do right now.
Yeah. Hello to Amy, who's listening to us.
Yes. Yes. She was actually in the house for a while.
She was.
A little chilly in here, so she went and sat in the car to listen in the radio, because she's got to listen to this on the radio.
Well, I'm surprised we haven't been hit up with a lot of messages so far, but
we might have. I've just been looking at the teams that you guys have chosen, so I haven't really checked mine. Oh yeah, she definitely voted for Patrick Cook as one of the offensive linemen. Just so you know, she's a smart woman. Smart woman.
Got to say hello to my mom and my aunt who are listening, the Grogans who are listening.
Yeah.
We got the modem back at the station.
Yeah, Lars doing a great job back there too. So shout out to Lars.
Exactly. Got to give him his props. So
I'm sure Andy Otto's listening, because I made some comments at lunch today as I was walking past him and Casey, saying that this was going to be a interesting show.
Yes. Yeah,
he did ask if there was going to be an all-injury team. I told him we did not have that. So
no.
I'd be him and Doug White.
Yes, yes, yes.
Oh, yes. No.
The best that never was.
Oh, my goodness. The best, though.
Yes.
For those that did not ever get to see him, you missed out.
Yeah, we would have had him and Clarence.
That.
Clarence on one side. We would have just thrown it deep every play.
Well, that would have been everybody who didn't see it, so.
Yeah.
Anyway. So, linebackers. We're into the linebackers here. Of course, for me, it was Josh Hoge, because otherwise he would have hunted me down and just, you know, probably tied me up and you know, hurt me pretty much, because he was an intense individual. Same way with Ross Steele. Of course, it was good to know that the final game of the year, whether it was a joke or not, that Josh Hoge's actually, his name was Hoge.
Hoge, yeah.
So I was good to know.
It's now Hawks. So.
You know, it only took 4 years to find that out or whatever. So, and then Fielding Brenner also as my top three linebackers. Casey.
Yeah, I had, I think I added Levi Hinicky in there, and then I also had on my second team, which, you know, as I mentioned, a really tough one overall for me, but I think Wes Coombs is one you can mention, Dakota Gettler as well. You know, those are both two solid choices. I mean, those are guys that can play inside or outside. I mean, even Gett played a little bit on the edge at defensive end, and that talented defense in 09. So, this is another position that's just loaded.
Yeah, that 08 and 09 team is pretty loaded with some athletes at the linebacker position. Of course, we were playing at 34 there, so it wouldn't have been no problem for you guys to choose four. But, you know, Ross Deal was probably one of the best outside linebackers, and probably one of the most physical specimens that we've ever had at linebacker. Hoge, same thing, huge in the middle. Fielding Brenner, another guy that could run in the middle. And then, like you said, Dakota Gettler, I thought it was a pretty good outside linebacker for us as well. And we, you know, fortunately, in that time period between basically 07 and about 11, we had some really good linebackers with us, and that's why we ran the 34 as much as we did.
Well, and I think what was impressive about the 09, you throw in a guy like Art Rubio who could throw it 75 yards. You always ask if he could get in there, quarterback, I know that, but, you know, that you've got three or four, in my mind, D1, you know, athletes that were back there, you know, just basically perusing everything, making plays in the run game, you know, could cover, and then you had always had Fielding, who was a sure tackler in there in the run game, so it was pick your poison, you know, for an offensive coordinator at that point.
Yeah, and that's why I think that was the year, I think, that we set the sack record that we still currently have overall. We must have had, like, 40 sacks or something like that year. It was a lot of tackles for loss as well.
A lot of feasts on the quarterback. It was a fun time to call that one. Now, the secondary, there is probably some misses, but For me, number one, without a doubt, Donald Anderson, just in the time that he, from when he made that switch and the impact that he had, to me, no doubt about being in that secondary. Logan Schultz was another kid that when he was out there on the field, you knew he was going to make a play, absolutely no doubt. Eric Brown was another guy that was just electric out there, knew what he was doing, and nobody was really going to try to test him. Now, I picked Devontae Corbett. I thought he had played well, and had some good periods there for Ottawa University. Casey, what about you?
Yeah, I think I would. You throw in Donald, of course, and then Eric Brown for me. I mean, probably the biggest win in program history outside of the Hastings game was the Missouri Valley game in 2013. Eric had three picks. He also blocked a field goal. So dominant. I mean, he won that game on the defensive side. I mean, offensively, it was tough because that Missouri defense was so big and physical up front. You look at other guys in the secondary, Joey Irwin, the two interceptions against McPherson in overtime in 2009. I think you kind of hit the nail on the head. I thought Devontae Corbett, a three-year starter, played over 33 games, 130 tackles, just was solid back there and just kind of was able to be the quarterback of the defense.
Hey, I agree with Donald for sure. Probably one of the best corners we had. Over time, we've had some pretty decent ones. Eric Brown was good as well. He was another one. Kid that was here just for a year and then couldn't return was Xavier Weathersby as a corner. But definitely Donald and Eric I'd put in there. And then, if I was picking two safeties to go into a game with for sure, one would be Logan Schultz because he was so smart. And then one reason he didn't get, unanimous is he had made Monty Lewis so mad in the games that we played against them because he called every single offensive play out before they ran it. And I think he mentioned to Coach Lewis that he needed to get a new playbook because he had it memorized, which didn't get him a vote in the all-conference thing. But it was he was definitely probably the smartest kid we had back there. And then Evander Williams is one that was off the list that I would go back and pick in a heartbeat as somebody that would definitely be a guy that you'd have back in there with those guys. And Joey Irwin was great. Devontae was good. But if I was picking one right now, I'd go EB, Donald, Evander and Logan, and we would be pretty solid with those guys.
Of course, it didn't help that the friend's quarterback, all he could do was lollipop passes in the air. So,
yeah, that's why Donald had so many picks. Donald would have like five picks a game every time we played friends. Logan told him where to go on every one of them.
Well, and I will say a guy that came in, for a year that was so physical with Nate Brudo. I mean, there was not a running back that looked forward to facing us that year. Because he would come downhill and hit you. A guy I liked at corner a lot in 07 and 08 was Chris Hurd. Just very smooth, and his back pedal always broke on the ball well, but another guy from 2007-2008 to mention.
All right. Well, Casey, thank you for coming along for the ride here.
Are we not
going
to do any special teams, Bob?
Well,
are we out of time?
Well, okay.
I'm going to say that Casey was the best kicker. Dom Segala second. Hunter would put it at probably Stamp because he got us more, or maybe Michael Siebold because Michael Siebold would get more personal fouls called against him than any person ever. So if that was a statistic, then he would win. But actually, Stamp was probably better.
We got about 10 seconds here.
Stamp was definitely statistically the best, but personality and just in overall, I think Siebold wins it with his character.
Character, yes. Put that word in quotes.
The character. Yeah, I would have chose Casey for the top kicker, but Casey wouldn't do that for himself.
That's good. Well, we called it out for you, Casey. All right.
There you go.
I appreciate it.
You're welcome. Best left-footed kicker we got.
Exactly. Well, that's going to wrap it up for us this week. Next week, we hope to be talking about a game. Let's hope so. But that's going to wrap it up for us tonight. For Casey Weider, for head coach Kent Kessinger, I'm Bob Johnson. We'll talk to you next Tuesday night.
Celebrating over 70 years of information, sports, and entertainment, we are hometown proud. KOFO K279CS Ottawa.
Here's the latest from ABC News. I'm Andy Field. It's a crucial first 2020 presidential debate for President Trump and Democratic nominee Joe Biden. ABC's Mary Bruce at Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland says the candidates have been gearing up for weeks.
The Biden campaign with this blunt statement to Trump: Mr. President, release